Riboflavin supplements, which form is best? Hi, I'm Dr. Chris Masterjohn of chrismasterjohnphd.com, and this is Chris Masterjohn Lite, where the name of the game is details, schmetails, just tell me what works. And today I want to talk about why regular, plain old riboflavin, the cheapo stuff, is a better choice than FMN, also known as flavin mononucleotide, or riboflavin 5-phosphate. So FMN and riboflavin 5-phosphate are actually the same exact thing. And you can find some supplements where they call it FMN, other supplements where they call it riboflavin 5-phosphate. For a very long time, for years in fact, I believed that it was probably better to take FMN or riboflavin 5-phosphate on the basis that it's closer to what you would get from foods when you eat riboflavin, and on the basis that some people have poor activation of riboflavin to one of the active forms, which is FMN, also known as riboflavin 5-phosphate. And so my logic was, if someone is not good at making this conversion, and hypothyroidism and hypoadrenalism are two conditions that would cause this, then it's better for them to get that form. I researched this intensively recently, and I decided that there is, for the average person, there is no difference between these forms. Riboflavin, riboflavin 5-phosphate, which is FMN, no difference. And the reason is that when you eat these compounds, you just cleave off the phosphate. And that's because phosphates have a negative charge. It's very hard to transport negative charges across cell membranes. And there are thousands of things in your food, thousands of different chemicals that have negatively charged phosphates on them. And it is just way simpler for your body to have enzymes that just clear the charged phosphates off of everything in your food than it is to have hundreds or thousands of different highly specialized transporters to try to get the form with the charged phosphate across the membrane into the cell. So what is the case is that in your intestines, you have this overwhelming abundance of several different enzymes that are overlapping and highly nonspecific in terms of which specific molecules they would cleave the phosphates off of. And they just cleave the phosphates off of everything in your diet. So that means that if you eat FMN, riboflavin 5-phosphate, that 5-phosphate just gets cut off and you absorb free riboflavin. So if you're going to absorb free riboflavin, if you take free riboflavin or if you take the 5-phosphate form, what difference does it make? However, I'm imagining that there may be some people who have small intestinal damage. If you have small intestinal damage because of bacterial overgrowth or celiac disease or any other of the malabsorptive disorders, you could have damage to those enzymes potentially. Maybe you aren't cleaving the phosphates off, in which case you're just not going to absorb it at all. So that's a theoretical concern. I don't know if it's ever been, I'm quite sure it's never been demonstrated to be the case that there are people with digestive problems who will not absorb the 5-phosphate form. But the way that I look at it is, at best, it doesn't matter. And at worst, people with digestive problems might not find the 5-phosphate form as absorbable. So the choice of supplement to go with is free riboflavin. Just go with a company that you trust in terms of their quality control and pick the free riboflavin. In terms of dosing, I think a good maintenance dose for most people is going to be about 5 milligrams per day. Unfortunately, there are not many low-dose riboflavin supplements out there. If I find any, by the time this goes to press, I'll put the links in the description of the episode. There are much more commonly doses of 100 milligrams or 400 milligrams or so. I don't think it makes sense to use these high-dose riboflavin supplements unless you have a specific reason to do so. I covered before experimenting with possible antifungal properties. In the next couple episodes, I'll talk about some specific cases where those high doses do make sense. I think it makes more sense to try to get your 2 to 5 milligrams of riboflavin from food and then choose supplements when you have a specific targeted reason, in which case you'll probably wind up using a higher dose. When you do, I think that for most people, riboflavin 5-phosphate might be fine. But why bother? The free riboflavin is as good or better. This episode is brought to you by Vitamins and Minerals 101.
This is my new free 30-day course providing one lesson a day on each nutrient delivered straight to your inbox. It can go to your email or it can go to your Facebook Messenger. If you get the Messenger version, it's taught by Chris Masterbot, my baby bot. It's more interactive. There are more emojis and there are more jokes. But both email and Facebook Messenger are incredibly educational. Each lesson covers why the nutrient is important to your health, how to know if you have too little or too much or the wrong balance with other nutrients, how to get it from food, and when you should think about supplementing. It is not a technical or advanced course. It is completely minimum in its technical jargon, and it is designed for the beginner with no background in nutrition and no background beyond high school in the basic sciences. Nevertheless, many people who have backgrounds in nutrition are saying that it is an amazing refresher course full of nuggets of valuable information in each lesson. Sign up completely free by Facebook Messenger or by email at chrismasterjohnphd.com/101. This episode is brought to you by Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet. This is my recipe to empower you to banish any deficiency or nutritional imbalance from your body. I've been through the pain of my teeth falling apart, my stomach being in constant pain, and my OCD going off the rails during my stint with veganism, to the point where panic attacks were the norm and I was afraid to eat any of the food in my house. I've been through the path of healing using nutrient-dense animal foods to nourish all the systems of my body and become a new person. But I've also learned that my needs change over time. The red meat and liver that were so healing in my recovery from veganism later started sapping my energy and brain power, only to find out that I'm genetically predisposed to iron overload and need to manage it with blood donations. And I've learned from friends, colleagues, and clients that everyone is different. Your needs are not mine. Mine aren't what they were 10 years ago. Yours won't be what they are now in 10 years. That's why we need a precise recipe to know exactly what's missing, exactly what's overloaded, exactly what's imbalanced, and an action plan to fix things, and a way to measure our success. That's what I've done with Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet. Get your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet and use the code LITE20, that's LITE and the number 20, LITE20 to get 20% off. For ad-free versions of these episodes with transcripts that you can read and getting early access to the episodes often weeks or maybe even months ahead of time, you can sign up for the CMJ Masterpass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code LITE10 to get 10% lifetime discount. The audio of this episode was enhanced and post-processed by Bob Devodian of Torian Mixing. You can find more of his work at torianonlinemixing.com. All right, I hope you found this useful. Signing off, this is Chris Masterjohn of chrismasterjohnphd.com. This has been Chris Masterjohn Light, and I will see you in the next episode.